Good evening. Topping Nightcast, a possible link between murder and music.
Music performed by a rock group right here in the Bay Area.
Four members of a Midwestern family were murdered. The 16-year-old son is the prime suspect. Members of the experimental rock group Negativland have been drawn into the case, and prosecutors won't even tell them for certain that their music, how their music might be involved. Hal Eisner has our report.
It was the kind of murder case that friends and neighbors said didn't make sense. They didn't understand how an A student from a good family could murder his brother, sister, and parents with an axe.
He was not a homicidal maniac. He did not show any signs of wanting to hurt anyone.
David Brom was accused in the multiple axe slayings, but now, almost 3 months later, many are still wondering why. One explanation may involve a Bay Area music group called Negativland. Negativland's music is highly critical of the mass media, nuclear war, and handguns. The group thinks their music is humorous, but they don't find it a bit funny that one of their songs poking fun of religion may have sparked a dispute among the Brahms, triggering the murders. They say federal authorities asked them to cancel a long-planned 17-city tour and eliminate live performances until the conclusion of the investigation. The probe apparently involved their song, Christianity is Stupid.
Christianity is stupid.
It's hard to listen to the cut and not laugh. If you have any sense of humor at all or whatever, it's hard not to see the humor in it, and that it would result in anything as serious as this, I think, is ridiculous.
This isn't the first time controversial music has been linked to tragedy. Charles Manson said his murder spree was influenced by the Beatles' Helter Skelter. It's believed Night Stalker suspect Richard Ramirez was influenced by AC/DC's Highway to Hell album. And Ozzy Osbourne's song Suicide Solution became the focal point of an actual suicide case involving a Southern California teenager.
What you can say is that music is a bystander involved to a certain degree, but most unlikely that it generated the mayhem. If it did, there'd be a lot more mayhem around.
Meanwhile, the members of Negativland are hoping for a speedy conclusion to the Brahm case in Minnesota and eventually a return to their live performances and a career that, after 9 years, had finally taken some positive turns.
But a quick end to the bizarre murder case may be in doubt. A Minnesota judge has ruled that David Brom will face trial as a juvenile. The prosecutor wants Brom tried as an adult, and he's appealing. I'm Hal Eisner, Channel 5 Eyewitness News.
It'll be several months before the court decides whether to try David Brom as a juvenile or an adult. The date for his murder trial can't be set until that decision is made. That means it's also not clear how long the band will be restricted from performing.
How do you feel about television?
It's going to make me famous one day.
why do you think that? Huh? Why do you think television's going to make you famous?
Because the media is exploitive. It takes an issue, it can blow it out of proportion, or it can take a serious issue and make nothing out of it. You got to know how to exploit the media.
Right. Thank you.
All right, we've been listening to Negativland, Helter Stupid newscast, which is came out of CBS News in San Francisco regarding my next guest and his band at the time, Mark Hosler from Negativland. And I must correct myself. I said Negativland played at Cowfish last night. I meant to say Mark, and get right up close to that, Mark.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
We have Mark Hosler sitting here.
I think that I'm a little, how am I doing in the mix?
You're doing fine, but get real close to that mic.
And I've got my morning voice on. So yeah. Good morning. A better future. radio sound.
We're going to do the weather here in a
We're
few minutes.
We're going to talk about all those people that Negativland killed in the 80s.
That's right, like that's that last guy.
With our music. Yeah, that clip you played is actually from a video, not from a... that's from a video we made, not from one of our records.
Right. Actually. It's referencing one of your records. Could you just basically explain what Helter Stupid, the concept of, or the actual reaction to that particular project by Negativland.
What? Huh? What did you? We heard a little. Hi, I'm Mark. How do you do? And, I'd spelled with a K at the end. Mm-hmm. C.
You're the not Mark time He's on this show.
Correct. And we're live on the. I'm live on the air for four or five more minutes.
Oh, until noon, actually.
What?
Yeah, we got.
Oh, the show goes until noon.
Oh, I thought it went to online only at 11 a.m. Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay.
We got Mark time.
I know.
Mark time.
Well, I'd like to go further back in time because if you're mentioning trying to explain to for those of you at home listening. Sorry, I'm barely awake.
no, you sound great, man. You sound great.
For those of you at home who don't know anything about what Mark's talking about or who I am, what I'm a part of and who I am. Negative Land is a rather hard to describe. It's very tough when I'm at dinner parties. Hard to describe artist collective that has been together since 1980. And we do music, sound, noise, collage, films, animation, radio shows, lectures, books. We've done a number of fine art shows, kind of everything we can imagine, even a teeny little bit of dance once.
And a website,
and of course. Actually, we had a website starting in 1995 when it was very strange have a website. Yeah.
It was one of the few places I was like, I had destination sites that I would go to when I would log on for the hour I was using it. And we had I would go to Negative Land, I would, check Discogs.
Wow.
A couple other things.
Was there Discogs back in 1995? No.
I think there was an early version of it.
No.
I think so.
All right.
I could be misremembering
and
as well.
And this is an era that those of you younger people in the listening audience don't know, but there was a period of time when it was considered incredibly gauche, is that the word? it was just bad form to advertise on the internet. It wasn't a shopping mall. It was a place for news and information and ideas and sharing and geeking out. And the fact that we were trying to sell our records, we kind of put it really hidden down low, and we tried to make it very, very low key because it was just considered to be gross. And of course, that's just that ended pretty fast, and now it is just a giant shopping mall and a place to go to only hear ideas that reflect what you already think. So don't use it to be exposed to anything new or different that you don't already think. It's just it's the opposite of what we all thought it would be. That it's become just a giant echo chamber bubble that people go in and all they hear are the ideas that they already think they know to be true. And it's terrible for democracy. Turns out it's terrible for democracy.
Well, and it ties into Helter Stupid in a way too, because you guys were projecting this fake news phenomenon that the internet has run wild with.
Well, no, we've been having an internal debate about this because what Mark, Mr. Time was playing earlier is Negative Land ended up doing a hoax that got way further into the media than we had ever expected, and we ended up then making an audio art project about the fact that we'd lied to the media and how far it went, and we were trying to make this piece that was kind of creatively and weirdly avant-gardely reflecting and ruminating on the fact that you really need to you don't trust the media, and essentially we were making a piece that's about how a lot of the news is kind of more or less fake. Now the term's been rendered meaningless because it's everyone. It's very strange to imagine that record now doesn't work now. I don't think
it really has a more retro feel than your other records because of that vibe.
Yeah, well, it's there was a brief moment when the term entered usage a year and a half or two ago when it really was referring to news that was. Essentially propaganda, but what it morphed into within literally a month was for our orange authoritarian malignant narcissist in chief to refer. He's just referring to things that he doesn't like.
Right.
It's meaningless now. But so that now the term is so broadly used, Yeah, it doesn't mean a damn thing. It's only instead of helping. The shocking, paradoxical, ironic thing about it is that instead of it helping people think in a more enlightened, deeper way, it's actually encouraged people to be stupider mm-hmm. and to not, you just to dismiss everything. Because yes, you need to read the New York Times with a critical brain. Yes, you do. But it's not all fake news just because it's in the New York Times, which right. is essentially the way it's now being framed. It's mm-hmm. just, if it's on CNN, it's fake.
Yeah.
And that's just, again, going, it's, that's terrible for
democracy. If you repeat something often enough, it becomes fact, and that's the new meme of
You mean if you repeat something often enough, it becomes fact.
No, I think he's saying that if you repeat something often enough, it becomes a fact.
It's yeah. possible.
It is a fact.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so that's, so we've entered in, as many other pundits have been saying, this kind of weird post-factual alternative facts as that, you know, as our well, our old friend Kelly blurted out a while back. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really, whew, it's really confusing and dangerous for us and for our country, but also for my group of friends making this weird stuff. it's caused us to reflect a lot on well, what do we do now? You know, and it's been really we've been stumped. Because we're not interested in making work that's super topical.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, we actually are, in a way, we're responding to our moment, but at the same time trying to make creative works that we hope will resonate 5, 10, 15 years later and not just be so, like, you know, if you ever listen to something like this, Stephen Colbert, what's his show now? The Daily? The Late Show?
There's one like of five those, night
one
shows.
One of those, you know. And well, I love the guy and his writing crew. They're amazing and they're brilliant. And they really do dissect the daily news in ways that are not only funny, but actually informative. I mean, you get a pretty decent update on a lot of what's going on just watching that guy's monologue and the way he picks it all apart. But you aren't going to watch those shows 5 years from now or even 3 months from now. They're over.
Right.
And
that's
they're
the
gone,
danger. It's kind of like a comedy record yeah. that you bring home and you play it for your friends. You play this comedy record. And when are you going to ever play that for your friends again? It's like, you know, those whole...
Yeah, if it's the Firesign Theater, you're going to play it over and over.
Well, no. They're the exception.
That's right. Which is why I love the Firesign yeah. Theater because yeah. that's a great example to me of... Wow, something else is going on here. I mean, you know, I listen to God. I grew up listening. My father listened to Bill Cosby all the time. Mm. I mean, I know all those.
I just dug out an old Bill Cosby record. It has a great bit on it about Spanish Fly.
Uh-huh.
And, yeah, there you go.
There is something, though, with like the Firesign Theater and with Negativland as well, with the timelessness of it, where it does age well, like where you can listen to it again 5 years later, and it doesn't feel like it's just George Bush.
Most of Firesign's stuff was not topical.
Right,
and that's why those records, when you listen to them now, mm-hmm. A lot of them are they don't date in the way that you would think. Like,
well, they did cover some themes, though. A lot of the themes they covered were the plight of the American Indians.
Yes.
Well, we still have the plight of the American
Indians. the military-industrial complex. They covered advertising and a lot of that.
Right,
sort
but
of
those
stuff.
Are but I would argue those are all subjects that are still completely relevant to address, and so they're not so topical. As we're doing a routine making fun of Richard Nixon.
Right. Yeah.
That's but, what they didn't do.
But even like on Bozos, which does have some kind of caricatures on it, like I just re-listened to that after going to Disneyland, and it feels way more relevant now than ever.
Like, actually, a lot of that was based on, there was the 1964 World's Fair with the Travelers exhibit. Mm-hmm. And the Travelers exhibit I went to, to date somebody. I was at the travel, and they put you on a train, and you'd go through, and they'd go, many years ago, amen, blah, blah, blah. And that's how that whole
record
Bozos record came about. Oh, by the way, I got to do some radio here. We are KWVA Eugene. This is the Reverend Mark Time on the Sunday Morning Hangover. And we're going to be talking here with Mark Hosler from Negative Land.
And
also on his own tour, Austin Rich and Don Haugen. But mainly we'll be talking to Mark here. Now, Mark, you played last night at Cowfish. How did it go?
Well, you weren't there. You could have told your listeners how it went, Mr. Reverend Time.
I explained on the air. I don't go to shows anymore because I got horrible tinnitus. Really? My ears.
I didn't know that.
All what the years I've been in rock and roll, right?
Uh-oh.
I've been, you know, a drummer. I cannot enjoy music live anymore. And I've got friends that come to town. They go, come down and see me. And I just can't because it's actually painful and disorienting.
Well, I am sorry to hear that. And that's a real thing. I have it a bit, too. I actually now have some ringing, persistent ringing. It only started in the last. In fact, the horrible thing is that when I built the setup I'm using to perform now with Mark Hosler's slow motion solo tour of the United States, taking place over a period of 1 year, where every few months I go out for a week or so, because I'm not going to do a big long tour. So this is just part five of a six-part. Eventually, I think I'm going to be doing part seven of a six-part tour, because I think there's another part coming up that I forgot about. But what I did was I spent about a year and a half building a brand new performance setup to use, and out of that setup is going to arise a show, and it's built to be very useful for improvising. And so the shows that I'm doing solo are 100%. Improvised, not so. When I sit down, I just have to kind of, you know, I heavily dose on my fish oil pill about a half fish pills before half an hour before I go on. So I'm peeking on the fish oil, and for some reason, it has the incredibly wonderful side effect of making my anxiety disappear, and I suffer from terrible anxiety, and I to this day, and so it in a way. Touring and performing is just the most horrible thing ever, and I always
doing radio interviews also.
Radio's fine. Radio's like this is I've done this is a, no problem. But it's really true that I'll be out sort of on the road, so to speak, and wonder why am I putting myself through this? So that's part of why I've kind of come up with my new geriatric avant-garde noise guy touring rules, you know, of no more than four shows in a row. I won't play places that don't have a stereo sound system and a subwoofer, have to have that low end, and stereo monitors. And if I'm being put up somewhere, got to have a place with a real mattress, not a futon, not the floor, not someone's couch. And then if the drive time between cities is more than like 4 hours, I won't play that day. I'll skip some days and then not be out for, you know, 2 weeks.
It's good. You got to pace yourself.
I am. And it's not being a diva. It's just trying to take care of myself so that I actually have a reasonable expectation that I will have an okay time sort of physically, you know, get enough sleep. And then I mean, of course, the pay is crap. So so I want to be sure that when I perform, it sounds great for
you
the audience.
You want to be comfortable. You know? It's not like the Foo Fighters where you got to pack up and go to the next town and, you know, get ready and do the. It's like do it at your own pace. I think that's a great idea.
Yeah. No, it's been working, actually. It's been very nice. You know, I'm staying here with my friend Kim. Thank you, Kim, for your hosting me.
Big shout out to Kim.
Yeah.
Radio Redux.
You know, had time to go hiking on Butte?
Spencer's.
On Spencer's.
Oh, cool. Either Skinner or Spencer.
You know, so that
Spencer.
Was, you know, that was so civilized, you know. And my God, the show last night started at 7:30. Like, what the hell? That was, I love that. And that's the other thing. I ask the venues if you can get away with it, if your audience that you get comes in, start the show as early as possible. Yes. So
well,
I,
what's
you know.
With those shows that start at midnight?
I actually won't do that. I actually just won't do that. And the thing is, I'm not. I just sort of say, I'm sorry. You know, this. I'll just sort of say no. But really, in the end, no. It the ultimate reason for all of the things is that I want to do an amazingly great show. That's my my bar and my mental bar of what I'm trying to do is that I want it to be. A you know effing great show every night, but I'm also making it up every night from scratch. So it's trying to be to tune in to that moment and channel the thing and you know make the magic happen. You know it's
how do you think you did last night?
I think honestly, I think last night was a some nights you do a good show and you have a good time doing it. Last night, I think I did a good show, but I didn't have that great of a time doing it. I was struggling. I felt like a little bit. I was struggling to get the flow right and figure out what was going on next. It just wasn't all Some nights it all just comes to you. It just comes and it just like it's just happening. And for, and last night it was more like I'm kind of fighting through a little bit of.
I have radio shows like that.
Like this is like a, like I'm trying to open a door that's stuck. Yeah, like okay, I'm gonna I got it open, but God, it was stuck for a while.
I know the feeling.
So no, but the audience in the end, I'm not there to have fun. At all. I am there to put on a good show, and that's true when Negativland plays, too, and that's something we used to have discussions about, is we're not up there to have a good time. Not at all. Now, if we have a good time, that's great. That's a bonus. But it's very different mindset to say, no, I'm up here to actually do a really good job for you, all the people who came out to experience this. You know, so it's ultimately... I'm sort of sounding like it's all about me, but it's not. It's actually all about everyone in the room. That's what the deal is. And so the energy was actually really great. The venue was willing to bring out chairs, which really helps to create a very different kind of dynamic because people are seated and kind of in repose, and they can really it encourages them to listen. And then as a performer, and I don't know about how you guys could speak to this, but as a performer, I really sense that. I'm picking up on that whole... Yeah. exchange, and I play better. And then my other new trick has been I don't set up on stage anymore. I set up in the audience. Yeah. And that way, and I have monitors, a little monitor, so I can kind of hear. For those of you out there listening who perform, you know that if you don't have monitors, you're hearing the sound bounce off the back of the wall that's behind the audience back at you, and it can sound kind of crappy. So I get little monitors on either side of me so I can hear a little of the detail of the sound, but I mostly, because I'm in the audience, I'm picking up this energy of this, literally the sonic sound energy of the room. Mm-hmm. So whatever I'm hearing is what you're hearing in the audience. It's the same thing. Whereas if you're on stage, you have no idea. The sound system could be great, the monitors could be crap, or the other way around.
I've been there where you're playing and you don't know.
No.
You so think just, it sounds like crap, but it actually sounds good out there.
So that's not is that enjoyable? No. So again, I want to have the confidence if I'm improvising, and it turns out that it enormously impacts in a good way my performance, because I know, like, oh, if this sounds good to me, we're good, you know, we're great. So
you made a good comment in Corvallis about the performance there, where you were saying that, I mean, you know, someone asked, "Oh, can I buy some of your new material that you do solo?" And you're like, "Well, this is for us in the room. This is for the people here that came to the show."
Yeah, I should have a recording, like my new instrumental solo album that I'm out promoting, but I'm just not interested. And what interests me is what's happening in that moment. Mm-hmm. And if you want a recording, well, you could have brought a recorder and recorded it from the audience. I'm happy to have you do it. But that's what interests me, actually, at this late stage of my aged noisemaking career. So
Before we talk about the past, let's talk about the future. You've got a gig tonight in Salem. You want to talk to me about how that came about? And
I have no idea. It's just basically a lovely gentleman named Seth Branham. Is it Branham?
I think so.
Yes, in Seattle, invited me to come out. He offered to fly me out to perform as part of his sound-making collective called Monster Planet that does a once-a-month kind of residential thing gig at the Rebar in Seattle. And he wanted me out to do, he knew I was doing these solo things, and he also wanted me to come out to improvise with them, you know, which I'm happy to do. And then I said, well, heck, if I'm already out there, I mean, I should do some more shows. Yeah. And so we started poking around, and my sense is that there is a loose-knit group of people and venues and, you know, this little network of people who do all the weird noise stuff, crazy sound stuff in the Northwest. So different people just kind of got wind of it. And things got set up in Portland, and here Don here in Eugene was the one who jumped in to make this show happen. But I'm going to be in Victoria, British Columbia, Vancouver, then down to Bellingham, where I'll be part of a 24-hour long performance event.
Yeah.
I won't be playing for 24 hours, but I will be part of it.
I was going to say, that's going to be tiring.
And I'm going to do I'll do a lecture at the university, then I'm going to do a workshop at Patchworks in Seattle at this modular synth store, and then finally end with a performance at Rebar on Halloween with Monster Planet. And then actually, for those of you who do know Negativland's work and may find this interesting, The day after that, I'm being interviewed for a documentary about the Reverend Estes W. Perkle. Reverend Estes W. Perkle is the gentleman that Negative Land sampled on our track Christianity is Stupid.
Oh,
that,
okay.
That he's the quote-unquote vocalist of that track. He made these. He teamed up with an exploitation filmmaker named Ron Ormond, and they would make these gory, shock horror Christian films to try to scare you into accepting the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal savior. So it would have things with communists capturing Christians and shoving stakes in their ears and blood pouring out dropping Christians onto beds of pitchforks. It's absolutely insane. B-movie schlock stuff made by this Christian guy. That's who we sampled on our record. And it turns out, which I didn't know, that it was our track that brought him to the attention of people who'd never heard of him.
Oh, thank you.
Yes. And it also turns out that he used to sell 16-millimeter film copies of these movies, and apparently he and his crew found out about our record. We never knew this. And they stopped selling those movies because they were trying to stop people from sampling.
That's outrageous.
Wow. Yes. This is pre-internet.
And
also,
hold on, back up. You're going to be... interviewing with this guy, you're going to be...
He's deceased. No, it's a gentleman named Brian Rosenquist is making a documentary
film.
Oh,
that's right. You're going to be interviewed for this documentary about the
guy's whole life. Oh, yeah, okay. And so we're part of that story, and wow. So that's, to me, just fascinating that this is being made, and, you know, happy to be part of it. Unfortunately, the guy, Richard Lyons of Negative Land, one of the co-founders who died 2.5 years ago, isn't there to tell. He's the one who actually found the record and brought it to the group and said, I think this is, you should listen to this. There's something in here. We could do something with this. And again, this is all, you know, pre-samplers, well, there were samplers in the 80s, but we couldn't afford them. So we were still cutting up tape with razor blades and all that stuff.
We're talking with Mark Hosler
and talking.
Don Haugen and Austin Rich, who played Cowfish last night. They're going to be playing Salem. What's the name of the venue tonight?
The Space Concert Club.
Space Concert Club. What time?
The show should start around 7. It should be a lot of fun. We're going to have solo sets by Don and I. Mark's going to close the night out. We're going to have a DJ doing some post-punk experimental stuff between acts. Yeah, you'll get some dancing going.
So Mark, status of Negative Land?
We're all dead.
I know. I was going to say, there's like so many of my old buddies who used to come in the record store and buy records and stuff are gone.
Yeah. Well, we unfortunately, I'll go back a little further. We were so happy to just make one record. And, you know, I mean, I was like, I can die and go to wherever you go after you die, because we made a record. You know, I mean, I was 18 when it came out. And we do need to give a giant shout out to your host, the Reverend Mark Time, because the education that myself and other members of Negative Land got around music was all because of this record store that Mark worked at in Berkeley, California, called Rather Rip Records. And there was a crew of other people, Mark Time, Ray Farrell, who else was there? Russ Ketter.
Oh, there was Rick Johnson.
Yeah, who I didn't know.
Paul Halliman.
Yeah, no, I didn't know those guys. I knew,
Mick McDowell.
Mick. So it was Mick, and it was Mick.
By the way, Peter Montgomery says hi.
Okay. No, it was really, it was Russ, Mick, you, and Ray that I think were the ones that probably wondering, who is this weird, nerdy 14-15-year-old kid coming in with all of his saved up paper route money.
So Mark and his friends
hear weird music.
Used to come in, and you guys were what, Concord High School or Walnut Creek High School?
I went to Ignatian Valley High School.
And you know, like Rather Rip was like the only store that had all this electronic
stuff.
Well,
it was what Rather Rip was doing, which a few years later it's what Tower Records started doing, but Rather Rip was one of only maybe two stores in the Bay Area that was selling imported music. And what was mind blowing for me as a kid who was listening to Gentle Giant and King Crimson and Yes.
Me too.
I was a total prog rock, you know. I tried to like Emerson, Lake, and Palmer, but
them. They were awesome live.
It was tough. But Gentle, out of that era, God, that mid period of Close to the Edge, Tales from Topographic Oceans, and Relayer, those records are still amazing, and all the Gentle Giant stuff up until maybe their seventh record, when they start to try and become new, more pop.
When they got rocked,
they blow it, and then they
went rocked.
But yeah, oh my God, that stuff's amazing. And what else? The first solo album by John Anderson of Yes, Elias of Sun Hill. Right. That record is amazing. That record's amazing. Anyway,
but
so
I
was into that,
here.
And hold on, I'm going to finish my story. And I was also getting way into. I was into Mike Oldfield, and then had discovered Tangerine Dream because I saw the movie Sorcerer by William Friedkin, which is a remake of Wages of Fear, and the soundtrack was like, what is that? And I found it in the record factory, and there was something on the back. I turned it over, and there was these things called synthesizers. Well, I didn't know what that was, and there was something called a Stratocaster, which I thought made sounds that were these weird, but it turned out years later I learned that it's effects boxes where you distort, phase shift, and echo, but I didn't know any of that. So what is this synthesizer, and what is this group Tangerine Dream? And someone at the store says, oh, you know, these like Mike Oldfield and Tangerine Dream records, there's other music that they've put out that's never been released in America. It's import only, and you can get it at this record store in Berkeley. And I was really confused, like, what? Because, I was too young to understand that, wait, there's music that comes out, but it's just only in other countries and not in America. Right. And so when I went in there, I mean, my mind was just absolutely blown. That like, what? And these records were kind of flimsy and thin, and they're in these loose bags, which Rather Ripped had a machine to bag them in the back.
A shrink wrap machine.
A shrink wrap. Yeah. Everything about it was so exotic. These German imports with everything's in German, you know, and so immediately the workers at Rather Ripped say, well, if you're interested in Tangerine Dream, look, check out Klaus Schulze, check out Cluster, check out Noi, check out Faust, check out Harmonia, then Modern Dance by Pere Ubu came out, check that out, the Duck Stab by The Residents came out, check out was the second or third annual report, Throbbing Gristle, you know, all that stuff is coming out, and then I'm discovering Philip Glass, Charlemagne Palestine, Terry Riley, all the minimalist stuff, Steve Reich. I'm into everything. I mean, I want Uprising by Bob Marley came out. But, yeah. You know, like, what's reggae? It turns out the first reggae record I get ends up being what goes on to be kind of a stone cold reggae classic.
Right.
And I want to hear everything. And I think you guys are like, oh, yeah, he's one of these, you know.
Yeah, you would walk in and we go, oh, you got to play him this new Noi record.
Yeah, and they would, these guys were my buddies who would, you know, oh, if you're in, you got to hear this new thing. And it was just so, and I was just this completely nerdy, beaten up, alienated, weird.
We played it loud.
Oh,
it was great. We had giant speakers and we would crank that thing up until your ears bled.
But here's the other thing about it that, like, back then, pre-internet, that was so crucial was you could pick out records you were interested in and they would do needle drops. They would play them. So I would want to hear so much stuff that the only way I could do it was I would arrive at opening and I would stay till they closed. I literally would stay all day, and I might go out to get a sandwich, but I would stay all day and wait patiently, because you might play a few and then say, well, Mark, we got to play other stuff by other customers who want to hear stuff.
Yeah, we'd have a lineup of records that we were ready to play for customers that walked in.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, again, this was just this was my education. And in hearing all this music, I would hear little bits of pieces of things, like on a Faust record or one track on Pere Ubu or This Heat, the first This Heat album. Oh, my God. I mean,
I remember that record.
Yes. Who, when I went to England with my family, because my mom's from Wales, I saw This Heat play in London in 1980.
Wow.
But anyway, just almost done, is that in hearing all this music, I heard glimpses and hints of something I wanted to hear an entire universe of, a whole record of like a certain something, and I couldn't find it. I couldn't find it, and I couldn't find it. And so at some point, I just thought, well, I'm going to make that. Mm-hmm. That's how that all happened. It was like, it was the one record that wasn't there that I wanted to exist. And by that point, I'd met Richard and David, and so we didn't call it anything until, we didn't even have a name for it until I think the record was done. and the other cute thing about it was that the only place we knew that would sell our record was going to be Ratherip Records and maybe Aquarius, and that was it. We didn't know anything about the world of distribution or how you get music out into the rest of the world or anything. We knew, you know, it was, so we were just so excited just to have it, just to see my record for sale in what to me is the coolest record store in the universe. And was when, just, and, I was totally
and
happy.
When we got that in, it was such a unique record that we went nuts. I remember putting the needle down and hearing this guy doing the Hail Mary. No, it was a group of people doing the Hail Mary, and you had it. I talked to you about this once, and you said it wasn't processed. It was just the way it came out over the radio, and it was like
it was back when you could tune, back when you had actual knobs and dials to tune the radio, you could tune in between the frequencies, and so it was just someone doing Hail Mary, Full of Grace, Mother God, Our Father. What is that? Who's Catholic here that can tell us? What is that called?
Wrong room.
What is it called? Is there a name for that whole thing? Are you just doing your Hail Mary? You're just doing your Hail Marys.
I can do 10 at a time.
Okay.
If I'm really bad, I have to do 20.
Oh, okay.
You're talking about confession, where you'd go to confession and you'd say, I did this last week. And the priest would say, you got to do three Hail Marys.
Male Harrys.
Male Harrys.
You had to go home and do 10 ejaculations.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't do that.
Yeah.
That was before Vatican II.
Wow.
I think we got in trouble for that in my house.
Yeah, I mean, I was doing
that. That was what the prayers were called.
Yeah. So when it came out, you guys were, I only found this out more recently from talking to your wonderful radio host here, that I guess when you were explaining this to other people coming in, you'd say, look, there's this really strange record that these high school kids made from the suburbs, not San Francisco, just from boring, dumb old middle-class suburbs. Check this out. And the other thing was, we didn't understand how to get record covers printed. I had there was nowhere to go to find out how to do this. So I just made the covers by hand in my art class in my senior year of high school.
And Richard, they were all like different.
Every single one was different.
And it was awesome because we had all these different records.
Yeah. So that turned out to inadvertently, it was a complete accident, but that was basically a selling point because it also drew people into, well, what is this? You know.
And people were like going, oh, I like this one. I'm going to get this
one. Right. You can pick the cover you like.
You know, because they like the artwork.
Yeah.
Your record and the first Feeders album, if you remember, the Feeders put out their first album, it was sandpaper on both sides. So
which was brilliant. So anytime you slid their record into your record collection, you ruined the other records.
Those
next
two
to
records
it.
Were the most unique records. But
no
I have here in my hand.
Yes.
I have here in my hand the first Noi CD.
Yeah, so we ended up, and when the record was finished, we were working on it, and we had sort of a so-called band meeting, and I said, well, you know, what do we call it? I mean, we're not a band in any sense. I still don't think Negativland's a band. I've never thought that, but why don't we give it a name instead of calling it, we could call it like the Richard Lyons, Mark Hosler, David Wills trio, but why would we do that? You know, and that's boring. And I had this sense from looking at the way you organize music in Ratherip that there were bins you ended up in. Like there were, you could be in the 20th century electronic music bin, and I said, I want to be in the rock music bin. The context to me is to be this avant-garde thing within a pop context. So why don't we say, let's give it a name like we are a band, and maybe that'll kind of help. So that was, you know, a fairly good insight for a 17-year-old. And we just started trying to think of names. And in classic, totally embarrassing fashion, we named it after a track on a record we liked. And that record was a record that of course, Ratherip introduced us to by the group Noi. The first Noi album has a track called Negativland, spelled the way we spell it, with the no second E.
Which leads us into this break. We're going to play that track, Negativland by
Noi.
Well,
some of it. It's very long.
Yeah, like 2 minutes of it. Just to give you an idea of the kind of music that we're talking about that was available at the time at that record store and the kind of things that influenced Negativland. We're talking with Mark Hosler, Don Haugen, and Austin Rich, who are on tour playing Salem tonight, experimental music, Mark from Negativland, and let's take a couple of minutes. of Negativland by Neu, a German band that was once the rhythm section of Kraftwerk, and a band that named a band that my guest was in, Mark Hosler from Negativland. So, Mark, do you have anything available right now, like CD releases, videos, anything that you want to talk about that is particularly on your mind that you'd like to get out there?
What?
This is called promotion.
No, I don't do that very well, and I don't know. Yeah, there's all kinds of. We put out a bazillion. The last record we put out was edited from our radio show, the Over the Edge radio show, called the Chomping Channel, and the Chomping Channel is kind of like an insane, psychotic, parallel universe parody version of a shopping network. And we sometimes do that on our radio, Negative Lands radio show, Over the Edge. It's a concept that gets revisited every so often, mm-hmm. over many, many years, maybe 10 years or more.
I think.
And we decided one of them was going to be good enough to edit it down to put out as an official release. That came out like a year and a half ago. And that particular release that particular Chomping Channel was about selling reusable music in smaller and smaller chunks, but also it was about selling things made from human bodily fluids and human remains. And the show's kind of done like a theater of the mind thing, where it's as if it's on television, but obviously you're imagining what we're talking about. And so that record, we finished the edit, it was all done. We were in the design phase and working on the liner notes, and that's when Don Joyce, who was the has been with Negative Land since almost the beginning, kind of came around 81, and had been doing. He's the man that kept Over the Edge Radio going all those decades. He died from complications from a lifetime of smoking.
Don and I used to
kids work. Don't do it. Right.
Don and I used to shows on KALX back in the late 70s, yeah. And I kind of bumped into him a lot. I never really knew him a lot, but him and I kind of ran the same circles, and it's just a shame that, you know, all our friends are just.
Well, just to go back to what I was getting at earlier, which is that we made that first record, and then I ended up going off on the whole story of it. But anyway, we certainly didn't think we'd still be doing this now. This is insane. I mean, how is this even possible? There was no plan. It's just that
you were going to be a fireman.
Yeah. Well, no, I wanted to turn my favorite H.P. Lovecraft stories into animated monster movies when I grew up. That's what at 13. That's what I wanted to do.
That's a good idea.
Who knew he was such a horrible racist? God, it's so sad to have to reconcile that with.
Hold on, I'm missing
him.
Something.
No, you're not.
Do you want to elaborate, or shall we just?
No, we're not. Just gonna. We're letting that. If anyone out there knows H.P. Lovecraft, and is a fan, you do have to kind of fold
reconcile.
Into your knowledge about him. But he is a shockingly. I knew it a little, but it turns out it's way worse than a lot of people knew. Anyway,
that's okay to presidents like that too.
Yes, I know.
Yeah, we're used to it now.
We're used to it now. Yeah. It's okay.
Yeah, we're in the land of new normal. Hey, yeah. The president can do it, everybody can do it. Let's
but
go
we,
on.
We ended up, yeah, we ended up, the response to that first record, you know, was that somebody who was running a distributor came into your store and found it, Systematic Record Distribution,
right.
And they contacted us and said, hey, we'd like 100 copies of your record. I think you gave them our phone number.
Right.
Or, you know, your staff gave them our phone
could have
number.
Been Ray, because Ray was really tight with those people.
Oh, he was. Joe Carducci.
Subterranean and Rough Trade.
Steve Tupper.
And Systematic and all those guys.
So we were blown away that they wanted 100 copies. That was just like someone who, that's like someone ordering, you know, 10,000. I mean, it was just a huge number. And a week later or 2 weeks later, they called and they said, well, they're gone. We want 200 more. And I said, well, where did they go? I don't understand. What do you mean? And they said, oh, we sell them to other record stores. Well, where? You know, because again, we're just naive about all this. And they said, oh, stores in like LA, New York, Amsterdam, Berlin, London, Tokyo. And I mean, again, just my mind is blown, and we're so excited and so energized by this because our Success for us was just so modest. Success for us was just, can we sell 50 copies in 6 months out of Rather Rip Records in Berkeley? Right. That's just like, we're happy.
Right.
So this was so exciting that that encouraged us to keep going. You know, there was just interest and excitement about it. And then Ian, who also has died in the group, he really, really pushed the idea of doing conceptual. Ooh, I like that. Conceptual records. And by the third record, we were doing, our first full-on bona fide concept album, a big 10A place. And from then on, we never looked back. You know, like they're all every record has been a concept record. So we keep going. And I remember at some point, as the years went by, decades go by, then we end up being sued. We end up doing that the hoax in the media, which, you know, that is an amazing adventure to go on. Then we make this record making fun of the band U2 and get sued by U2 and their record label and their publisher and all that. And that turns into a giant life-changing odyssey that turns into a book, a documentary movie. I end up ending up with a whole... I make a living doing... For 10 years, I made a living doing lectures about Negative Land's work all over the world.
That one you did at the U of O, like 2011 or something, when I saw you, was just incredible. The one Kim was in on.
The stories end up becoming crazy of what we end up getting to art and activism and can we say poop on the air? Poop stirring.
Yeah.
that's a shout out. Anyway, and so it, you know, being sued by the world's largest rock band is very difficult, and I did sometimes end up in tears, but it certainly makes your life really interesting when your art is about the media and it. Our work is dealing with these issues. It evolves into becoming much more of a political thing.
Can we zero in on that U2 thing for a second? Because a lot of people in the audience aren't aware of Negative Land's lawsuit by U2 and all that other stuff. Can you just give us a thumbnail sketch as to
how
happened?
Well, okay, I don't know how.
Well, maybe
read the book.
I'll start it and you'll correct me.
But so, I want to get back to the bottle human remains and bodily fluids thing.
The chopping channel is very important.
No, I just want to say that U2 thing, which is sort of known as either your hit single,
a hit lawsuit,
or your hit lawsuit was your claim to fame. That was where you guys had like worldwide fame, and I think it's real.
Only because, the only reason that got attention, again, pre-internet, folks. When we were sued over that record, it's a record that looks like a new album by U2 called Negativland, not the other way around. We stole their name and made a record that samples from them. You can't play it on the air. It has all kinds of bad language in it. But the track that has all the bad language in it is called Special Edit Radio Mix. And so when it went out to radio stations, we hoped that unsuspecting DJs would see the title and just put it on the air as a new Negativland record. And we found out that, in fact, yes, that happened. And what also happened was that U2 was about to put out a brand new record album called Octoon Baby. And the release date of our record, for various mundane reasons, got delayed about 6 months. And so when the record actually came out, which at that time we were on SST Records, that's another whole part of the story. We ended up being sued by the founder of Black Flag.
I've heard stories about SST.
Yeah, so things get ugly. It makes for good stories, but when you go through it, it can be ugly. But it turns out that when the record came out, it dropped, as we say, a month before the new U2 album, so it looked like a pre-release advance single. So that's part of why they just went ballistic.
That's so great.
Yeah, so that
an accident of timing.
That was true serendipity that worked out to our advantage. And so the lawsuit hit only like 10 days after the record came out. So we were sued for sampling, for fraud, because it looks like a new U2 record, for trademark infringement, for defamation of character, because we were associating this foul language with the clean-cut image of the band U2. They sued us for everything you can imagine. It was Madonna's lawyer they hired to do it.
Wow.
And because what we did was we sampled and appropriated from things that don't belong to us to make our work, that this lawsuit, in fact, was about everything, our entire working method. So we realized back then we had a chance to talk about these issues. We could see that these things called electronic bulletin boards were going to, computers were getting cheaper. It was very obvious to us that we were quickly entering a world where much information and so-called property is ones and zeros. What happens when everything's digital and you're sharing stuff and you can't control the gatekeepers, the monetary gatekeepers of information and data and culture and movies and records can't control it anymore, there's going to be things are going to get really interesting. And we are a group of artists who want to make music and art and sound responding to that world. So it's not that I'm going to write a song about the birds and the bees and flowers and trees. I want to make a track that's actually about the pop culture I've shot into my brain, whether I like it or not, when I go eat at a restaurant, all the advertising for Pepsi and for Wells Fargo and Bank of America. You know, we're surrounded by this stuff. Everywhere we are in the modern world, we're bombarded by pop culture and corporate logos and information and branding. And it's just awful. It's just ugly. It'd be lovely to live in a world where it was all gone. But me and my friends want to make art about it. And guess what? We're going to take bits and pieces of what you actually are putting into my mind without my permission. We're going to use that stuff to make our stuff, and that should be okay, because we're not actually pretending to be, you know, we're not bootlegging you. We're making something original by using things that were already made. So that's kind of our
whole
working
method. What year was that?
91 when it came out.
And so you guys actually were on the forefront of this whole kind of sampling, appropriating, I don't know what you want to call it, kind of morphing pop music, taking pop music and actually turning it inside out.
Well, we were, and the thing was that we felt like the proverbial canary in the coal mine. So it was when we got sued, the sense was, we've kind of been handed our mission from God, and we are the people who are going to have to get this dialogue going, because nobody was speaking about these issues from a very progressive, forward-thinking, culturally enlightened point of view. And we realized, well, we can do that. And because we've been sued on behalf of the world's largest rock band, which they were at the time, there was no one that could top them, we correctly guessed, having gone through the Helter Stupid hoax and dealing with media, that the sort of the bright, shiny package that would get the media to write about it was do-gooder, liberal, lefty, mega rock band crushes little tiny nothing avant-garde poopster group who was making fun of them. And that would be the why they'd write about it, but that then in the articles they would really talk about the real issue, which is, you know, who owns information, who owns culture, what are we allowed to do with it as humans, as creative people, and that's a conversation that needed to happen. We then decided to make a book that documented what had happened. A guy named Craig Baldwin ended up making a documentary film. So by the late 90s, we weren't seen as being completely crazy, which we were at the beginning. But I think but more and more there were people in the political, academic, legal world who started saying, no, these guys actually have a point. And so by the mid to late 90s, there started being conferences around intellectual property and fair use in the arts and trademark and what do you know? They start asking, they start saying, let's get one of those Negativland guys out as the token. I became the token artist that would be at a lot of events at Duke University, MIT, right. Yale. I mean, it's crazy where I ended up getting to go.
Well, because you were at the forefront of this, which nowadays doesn't seem so revolutionary.
No. It's right. It's not. It doesn't seem transgressive. Now, once YouTube hit and, computers just went everywhere, the idea that you can grab bits and pieces of things and remake them into things, every kid knows that. Yeah. Now. So it's a different, I feel like our job is done. I mean, we don't sample from other people's music anymore. It's not interesting.
So what is
next? We gave that up.
Is there a Negativland? Is there still a Negativland?
Well, yes, of course. Yeah, because it turns out that when you don't say who's in your group, we've sort of been semi-anonymous for almost the whole time.
Yeah.
We don't say who we are in our publicity packages or our photos. We try to just direct. We're not trying to be secretive. It's just we want to direct the listener to the work. And we're not interested in playing those normal rock and roll ego games.
Right.
We'd like to avoid that as much as possible because it's just kind of, I think, more personally healthy for us. But also, it's just nice to always screw around with tropes and forms and mess them up and not play by the rules. Any chance you can get in
that's
any way.
That's real punk rock.
That's true. And I think by my sense of what was punk, which was more the spirit of it than the sound of it, I do feel like Negativland tried to be very punk rock.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I mean, and like we were talking earlier, when punk rock started, it encompassed a whole wide range of stuff. It wasn't just the B-52s or it wasn't like Black Flag or it wasn't Zev. It was everybody.
I think it was, to me, it was as much of a sound as it was as an attitude and a spirit, and I always felt they were basically 50-50. And yeah. And but very quickly it turned into a kid wearing a Dead Kennedys jacket,
fashion,
and a style and a more brand. It and that to me wasn't very punk rock.
Yeah.
That's why I really liked the when that album No New York came out.
Yeah.
To me, I thought, oh, that's punk rock, because it's just going to keep pushing the envelope. And when Wire, that, you know, to me were the quintessential, if you look at the evolution from the first to the second to the third Wire albums, to me that was like, oh, that's punk, is that you just keep evolving and evolving and evolving and pushing the envelope of what you are doing and what your listeners will accept that you will do. But, you know, that's it turned into other names and other genres.
So you're on tour.
I'll go back to, but just to answer your question, is that it turns out sort of in a sort of a weirdly funny way that we inadvertently picked the way we picked to kind of operate our career turns out to work really great when everyone starts to die because
so
people
sad.
Aren't focused on the individuals. You know, it's not like, oh my God, John Lennon's dead. I mean, it's not like that. It's just, it's still more about the work. And we have so much material in our archives of bits and pieces made by the three folks who've died that we are using them. We're collaging with all their stuff.
So they're still alive.
Well, for a while. We're going to run out of it. But we have a lot of really great... Yeah. And by the nature of our work is that it feels totally good and right that we're taking chunks of things from that Don has collected over the last... You know, since 1981, and we're incorporating them into our own the new stuff we're working on. So yeah, so there's a bunch of material. And another fun little we have enough for either a double album or a two single albums. Maybe it'll come out as a part one and part two. We have, interestingly enough, we've got piano, drums, bass, guitar. There's a lot of live drumming on the track, played by Prairie Prince of the Tubes.
Oh,
the
yeah, interviewed him.
The drummer on My Life of the Bush of Ghosts. He knocked it all out in one day because he's so good. We just played him all of these
played
tracks.
Played with XTC, played with the Tubes, everybody.
Unbelievable. For me, I mean, oh my God. And he's, you know, he's incredible. So we thought it would be interesting.
You got Prairie Prince to play on a Negativland record.
Well, that's
I can't believe this.
That's because John/Wobbly is friends with him. It's not
you guys have hit the big time. You guys are part of the elite now.
There we go. Yeah. But it's trying to make you want to make a record. We hope this new record sounds it does enough of the things that you maybe want Negativland to do if you like our work, but we also want to surprise you. You know, we want to do things you don't expect. So
when will it be out?
I have who cares? I don't know. It's not we're not on any turn.
Have you thought about doing a rock record and then like the stuff left over, put out a couple more albums after that. I was thinking maybe a record with five songs on the side one, five songs on side two.
Oh, I've heard of that. That's such a funny idea.
Yeah.
No, it all has to hang together. And so we've got a lot of material, and the trick is trying to figure out how it all hangs together and works. And we now are in a world where there really aren't so much albums, people to listen to things on random shuffle play. So it's very challenging and kind of been depressing and disheartening that you got to make a record. We've spent our whole lives making these concept albums, and you now kind of have to think about how do these tracks work if you don't hear them in the order we want you to.
Right.
You just hear them in random, and we're kind of making them now have a little bit more of a beginning, middle, and end, so they kind of work all on their own, which works, but it turns out to sequence a record where every track has more of a beginning, middle, and end, boy, it's a bitch to sequence them. So that's really confusing, too. So... to go back to our human remains and bodily fluids, and that everything is grist for the mill. So when this record, if you can back up people, your brains, to the Chopping Channel project, so the one that's all about selling things made from human remains, bodily fluids, et cetera, we're done with the record. We're really happy with it. It's going to be the next Negativland record. We've got the packaging design. We're working with a satellite member of a group, Sean Wolf, who's in Seattle, a genius designer guy we love working with. And we've got the liner notes done. And then Don goes into the hospital and has a blood clot in his lungs. And they try to, or not his heart, near his heart. They try to get at it. It breaks apart, goes into his lower organs, and blocks all the blood flow to his organs. And they have to cut his abdomen open, pull that out. And at that point, he's so messed up. He's in the hospital. He's got 14 tubes in him. I counted. And
yikes.
And we were, in a way, terrified. It was horrifying to think he was going to die, and it was also horrifying to think he would live, because if he lived, he was just going to be in a wheelchair. And he lived, John's whole life revolved around doing Over the Edge and doing audio art. I mean, he literally once said, if I couldn't do this radio show every week, I actually would really just kill myself. I'd just rather be dead. I mean, that's how I feel.
This is like the highlight of my week.
That was how committed he was to doing that. His practice, his audio collage on the radio, which he did for 34 years for volunteer on KPFA. And so it was, and we were his family. I mean, he didn't have any family. So it was so intense to, you know, trying to give him good care, dealing with the legal things and hospital, all that stuff, and wanting him to pull through, and then thinking, if he pulls through, what are we, oh my God, I mean, what are we going to do? And in the end, he, 3 weeks from his last radio show, he was gone. He died. Yeah. So it's he really did, the guy lived the life he wanted to live and did what he wanted to do, and it really was just a trip for those last few weeks.
What more could you ask?
You know, really, it really was amazing. And I did tell his, I was talking to his sister and saying, you know, your brother really, you know, or as his sister, she said, Donnie always wanted to be an artist, even when he was just, you know, when he was just 10, that's all he wanted to, do was do art. He was very shy. He didn't like being social. He hated touring and dealing with people. He just wanted to focus on the work. I don't think he even liked being in a group. He tolerated us because he could tell that the work was better because of a collective brain making it. And that's what mattered to him more than, you know, he'd put up with all of the nonsense of dealing with all our weird personalities. Because I think he was
How many
very
guys
inclusive.
Have you had in the band at a time?
Well, it's just, again, it's just not, it doesn't work that way.
Well,
you're asking
I know you're not a fixed band, but.
No, it's
but
just a loose. It's
are you
a,
talking about five, six
no,
people?
Nine, maybe nine people.
Okay.
And so it just, but there are people who are involved all the time. Some people were involved more and then less, but whenever someone's working on a project, they're very much an equal part of the group. We don't worry about defining it. It doesn't matter. We're not worried about letting you know that, and we don't, you know, you guys who people who listen can figure it out. So, anyway, Don dies. We have this new, you know, we did our sort of memorial to him was we went on the day after he died, we went on the radio and we did an Over the Edge show all about him and all about, we played some great stuff. Don never laughed on the air or broke character, really. He basically, in 34 years, it happened twice. Mm-hmm. And there's one show where he absolutely loses it on the air, and it is just the funniest. It's so beautiful. We played that and various things. And, so we got this record, you know, that's by gosh, it's all about selling things with human remains and body fluids. And what do you know? We've got about 8 pounds of Don, in his ashes. And so we decide that the proper thing to do is that we are going to put this record out, and the first 1,000 copies, you're going to get a quarter teaspoon of Don in a little bag. That comes with every
oh, that's so awesome.
Every copy. And we felt like Don would love it. You know, that the idea that even that one is that his death could be inspiration for more creativity and for our creative practice and our art. And also the idea that nothing is off limits to be used in our work, that even our own bodies could be appropriated to be used in our collage.
Sure, about the girl that brought her grandfather's ashes and cookies to school, and she fed the cookies to her friends. Did you hear that? That was in the news this week.
No, but
sorry.
I think Peter tasted Don's ashes. He said they were a little sweet tasting. He tasted them. I mean, you know.
Is that going to be on your next release? You're going to have actual ashes from Don in it?
No, you're a little behind here. No. That was a year, and that came out. That's
2 years ago.
Yeah.
Can you still get those?
Well, the ashes ran out.
Yeah.
And we're not, you know, I mean, you know, these people who died were my oldest friends, too, and collaborators. Yeah. So I actually spooned them in. I did all the, and it was an interesting, ritual to do. I was very uncomfortable at first. I thought, well, I'm going to wear gloves and a dust mask. I mean, I just, the whole thing of handling someone's human remains was very, very bizarre. But the funny thing was, it very quickly becomes quite normal. And in the end, You didn't care. In fact, even when I just used the spoon that I used to measure him was just my normal little quarter teaspoon thing I use when I bake in the kitchen. And and there was a little bit of ashes still on the table when I was done, and I just wiped him up with the kitchen sponge, because in the end you're like, you know, it's not going to hurt you. It's fine. It's just this dust. There's bone fragments in there, though. There were little bone fragments. And I had to do the math because I wanted to make sure everyone got enough of the ashes to feel like you got some, but we didn't want to give away too much because we wanted to have as many baggies as possible. So I actually took this, I think I had this container of glutamine powder, which I used as my kind of substitute to be able to test out, well, what's an amount that works, you know. And I kind of came out, we ordered the bags. Sean Wolf designed these beautiful stickers to go on them. We also gave away 800 of Don's carts. Don did all the live cut up he did on Over the Edge and our live shows was done using old school analog radio station cart machines, which are used to play commercials and jingles and sound effects. We use them to do live cut up. We still do cut up, but no one could play the cart machines. Like, Don would use four of them on the air and on our live performances. So when Don died, we felt like that creative technique died with him. We have all these carts, and we, again, like the idea of, we're going to give away to you, the fan, an actual cart with his handwriting on it that's an actual original one-of-a-kind analog tape that was used to make Negativland stuff. And we didn't have 1,000. We had about 800 of them. And those were all given away as well. So there, and we decided also, kind of from a ethical, moral, philosophical standpoint, the record was for sale for just a normal CD price. It was just $13, and the ashes in the cart was just a gift. You know,
what was the title?
It's Negativland Over the Edge, Volume 9, The Chopping Channel, and we did that. And I also kind of guessed that. That once this news, once this got into the news that we were doing this, that it might get a little attention. And Boing Boing kind of was the place that kind of announced we were doing this, and it actually did go very viral. It was on 500 websites. We ended up on MSNBC, NPR. Two different TV morning shows did things on it. They didn't even understand what we were doing at all. They just thought it was just freaky and horrifying that we were doing it. And so I remember thinking, this is probably the last thing we will ever do that gets this kind of, I mean, basically.
I don't think so.
Yeah, no.
I think there's more.
No, there is. No, you're actually wrong. There is, if you understand the way the climate has changed, hoaxes, fake news, it is the world that we're in now.
Well, that's
is
where we
world.
Came in, isn't it? That's where we started.
It's the world that we're in now is the world that we were kind of poking around in, and we're in that Negativland world now. Yeah. And so I remember thinking, it's really amazing that after all these years, after at that point, when did it come out? 36 years of doing this, if we could cause people who enjoy our work and the media to have one more WTF moment about Negativland, I am so happy, and that's a gift from Don. You know, that's what we get.
I think that deserves a round of applause, everybody in the room.
So that was, but I really don't know. You know, we're going to keep doing work and try to do cool stuff and do, you know, we won't put out anything unless we think it's, you know, up to the Negativland standard. Of course not. But, yeah, it's a different world. So nowadays, you know, I'm going around doing solo shows playing to, you know, 30 or 40 people.
Which brings us back to promoting the gig. We're talking here with Mark Hosler from Negativland, Austin Rich, and Don Haugen, who are preparing live. In Salem, where?
The Space Concert Club on Edgewater. Should start at 7 o'clock, and it's going to be a lot of fun.
There's more, and I'm doing a little, it's a little Northwest tour.
Yeah, where are you going to be playing next?
So also Belling, I can't remember the names. You'd have to look up the Negativland Facebook page.
And Washington, you know. And Furman.
I'll be in Bellingham and Seattle and Vancouver, and I was already in Corvallis and Portland, and I'll be up in Victoria, B.C., with a day off to go hiking in the woods, which should be lovely.
Oh.
That'll be nice. And then I'm also, the next little part of my year-long tour is in January, I'm going to play in Savannah, Georgia, Jacksonville, Tampa, St. Petersburg.
That's your neck of the woods, right?
No, well.
Don't you live down there somewhere?
I'm kind of living near Asheville, North Carolina, the mountains. But I'll go down to do Miami, do Fort Myers, think Tallahassee. No, Sarasota and Gainesville.
Yeah.
So there'll be a hole, and that's going to be good because that'll be warmer to go in the winter months. Yeah, that'll be nice.
How can people find the music of Negativland and Mark Hosler? You have a website?
Well, there is a Negativland website. Negativland spelled the way.
Without the E.
Second E. Just, enter it in. Even if you spell it wrong, we're the first thing that comes up in the internet.
And let me get Don to see if Don has anything, any websites to go to.
I have a SoundCloud and Bandcamp.
Bandcamp
and SoundCloud, yes.
How about you, Austin Rich?
Check out MidValleyMutations.com to follow all of the radio stuff, and then Mini Mutations links off of there.
Yes. And it'd be lovely if people do buy our stuff, you can buy it from us mail order through NegativeLand.com. However, if you really, really don't, every single thing we've ever made has been stuck onto YouTube, which we just don't. We'd like to get the money from it, but we're not going to.
Which is where I got the next track was YouTube. It's
Negative
Land's Freedom Waiting. Freedom's Waiting.
Freedom's Waiting. That's a nice one.
Is that air friendly?
It is. We don't use, there's not much swearing on our records.
Well, I want to thank you for coming in. I know it was early. I know you had a gig last night. I'm really thankful that you guys are on the planet because you're really keeping things edgy. Keeping it real, Mark. It's so good to see you.
Oh, check
again.
Out and Austin's website. Austin is a great. The interviews. He's interviewed all kinds of people, and I have to say, Austin is incredibly knowledgeable about what when you talk to him and get interviewed by him, and you're really
Austin. Your
really
radio
does
show.
A great job.
I do an interview show called WTBC Radio and Beautiful Anywhere Anywhen. It's a podcast, and I've spoken with all the members of Negativland.
Yeah, but
so
loads
far.
Of other people, and he's I've done a lot of interviews, and I can he's on it.
Oh, thank you so
he
much.
He knows his stuff.
I see the next DJ Chamomile's here, so we're going to. Leave you with a track from Negativland. Don't forget, tonight in Salem, Mark Hosler, Don, and...
If I haven't died by four this show,
Austin Rich, I want to thank you guys for coming in.
Yeah.
And this has been the Sunday Morning Hangover here on KWVA.
Hungover.
Our Father, which art in heaven,
humble words.
We shall fight on the beaches. Trinchant. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
Trinchant words.
Thundering. Give me liberty. Thundering. Give me liberty. Won't give me death.
Thundering words.
The strongest words. The strongest word. The strongest word.
Persuasive.
The strongest word. The strongest word.
Inspirational words.
The strongest word is still the word free.
Grateful words.
Free. The word free. The strongest word is still the word free.
Men have lived for words. Men have died for words.
Voided words.
Cities have fallen for words.
Freedom's waiting.
Free. The right words.
Iraq, inflammable.
The right words.
Islam, insidious.
The right words, said Lenin, are worth 100 regiments.
Freedom's waiting.
Infamous chorus.
Steering words.
You can say four blunt words and a man will hit you in the face.
Words.
Freedom's waiting.
Israelic words.
Words.
Sturdy. Implacable.
Tramp. Sarcastic.
Irreconcilable.
A little deluge of adjectives.
Words.
The strongest word is still the word free.
Free.
Next to the word free, the best word is new.
Persuasive words.
The best word is new. New. New.
At your 7-Eleven, freedom's waiting.
For your kind of morning, our kind of freedom.
For you.
Other tested words are mistakes, stop, at last, and don't.